Yeah, hi everyone. Welcome to Moonshots and the Politics of Science Funding. I'm Eve Slavich. I'm a Science Party Senate candidate, and this event's been organised by the Science Party as part of the Sydney Science Festival week. I'm doing my PhD in statistical ecology. Environmental science, which is an area that's certainly not immune to the politics of science funding. So science is advancing, but the problem is that not all of it can be monetized. So there's heaps of areas like epidemiology and theoretical physics that need external funding. So our speakers tonight are going to touch on some of these issues. They're going to look at Australia's contribution to science, breakthroughs, our place in the world, in the what our contribution to science might be in the future, and how science can contribute to keeping governments accountable. So I will just let our speakers do all the talking. Our first speaker is Tom Gordon. So Tom has a bachelor's degree in astrophysics from Sydney Uni and a from ANU and a graduate diploma in science communication from who studied in the international space industry in France and Portugal. He's worked as a high school teacher teaching science for 4 years, and he's now a science communicator here at Sydney Uni, and he's also the Science Party communications officer. So you can sometimes find him running very entertaining quiz nights at a brewery less than a kilometre from here. Called STEMpunk. It's like science, maths, engineering and technology questions. So it's very fun. So Tom's now going to take us on a tour of Australian innovations through time and space. Tom.
All right. Welcome to Science Week, by the way. I love Science Week. And thanks for coming along to hear our ideas about science funding and politics and science and how they mix together. What I'm going to do is I'm just going to give a really quick, short introduction to Australian science and technology. I'm not going to cover everything because that's going to take longer than a quick little bit. And I've just chosen some of the things that I thought were quite cool, just to set the scene for what we're going to talk about in a little bit. At any time, she's throw some hands up and ask me some questions. So yes, Australian science and innovation. The first innovation from Australian science, and one of my favourites that we always talk about, is the banknote. All right, so this is a Syro invention, the banknote. It's two polymers at different directions, they crush them together, and it's almost indestructible. It's also one of the biggest plot holes in our movie Two Hands. I don't know if you've ever seen that movie. Yeah, Heath Ledger puts the notes in under the sand, but they're plastic. You could have taken them into the water and then none of that stuff would have happened. Anyway, that doesn't matter. But on the banknote is a very important Australian. His name is David Unipin. I don't know if you've heard of David Unipin, but he was basically the Elon Musk of the indigenous population, right? So he was a prolific innovator. He innovated lots and lots of things. He innovated, or he tried to invent a helicopter, very much like Leonardo da Vinci's helicopter. And he made something that people still use today, back in the day. He was an indigenous man, excellent at science, excellent at English literature and grammar and all that sort of stuff. Very, very cool guy. And he's got a picture of his invention on the banknote, which is a mechanical shearer. So this was one of his innovations that we still use today. Really, really cool. And we should be celebrating David Unipin a lot more. What's that? Unipin. 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 Yeah, right.
Yeah, it's AI.
You nape? Yeah, there you go. I put that in there. Thanks for pointing that out, because yeah, I put that specially in there, so just to see if you guys pay attention. Good. I didn't. No, I may have put more in there just to see. Whatever. So this is the only graph that I have. We'll be seeing some more graphs later on. But this is like one of those really quick graphs of 100 years of CSIRO. This is what they like to talk about. There's lots of innovations in there. We've probably seen a lot of them. There's the Hills Hoist in there, Wi-Fi, all of that sort of stuff. I'm not going to read those out because you can do that yourself. But there's a few of them that I'll mention. One of them is ultrasound. This was an Australian innovation. So universities around Australia work together to make ultrasound, and that's obviously very good for medical technologies, for medicine, for how we diagnose cancers, or sorry, diagnose, not cancers, conditions. Ultrasound is one of those really, really cool technologies because it's non-invasive, right? So it's a really, really nice way of getting diagnosis of things that could go wrong without being invasive.
Sorry, what lecture is
it? I don't know how to answer that.
Oh, yeah,
yeah,
that's
No, you're right. I like this picture because it says Twin B, which obviously means that someone had a surprise that day. Radar. One of my favorite things was developed by a CSIRO scientist. Her name was Ruby Payne Scott, and she did a lot of the development work into tracking enemy warcraft World War II, obviously, because there's aircraft. she's so famous that they even made a Google Doodle of her. That's the Google Doodle of Ruby Payne Scott. I'm not going to talk much about that because that's not necessary. I just want to talk about the fact that she did good work and she's Australian. This is Woomera. We have an X launch facility here in Australia. It's at Woomera. And these are some really awesome photos that were taken back in the day. This was in the 1960s with a launch called Blue Streak. This was an English launch. There's another cool one here at on the other side that kind of looks like the Dragon rocket coming back down, but it's not. It's just lifting off. This is a picture down the bottom of what the launch pad looks like. It's desolate now. They don't do anything there except for about 10 years ago, they launched this thing here, which is a high shot rocket. So that's University of Queensland students going back out to Woomera, launching a rocket that broke. They broke records of supersonic combustion. It's called a scramjet. So the combustion inside the chamber, the rocket chamber, was at supersonic speeds, which means that rocket went hypersonic speeds, right, 10, 15 times the speed of sound, which is really, really cool. The cool thing about that is that they had to develop this with almost no budget. NASA was doing this at the time as well. They spent millions and millions of dollars, and we had a university like sub-faculty budget in University of Queensland to do that. One of the cool stories, I was talking to some people who were on that project. You know the thing that spins tires around to see if it's balanced or not? Yeah, that's what they used to make sure that the rocket was balanced. NASA built an entire machine for that. They spun it on a little tire spinning thing. And it was close enough. And they beat NASA. They did this before NASA did. robots, the theme of Science Week this year is robots and drones, so we're big on that. And the robots are going to be really, really important to us, and we have a lot of cool innovations for robots in Australia. This is a robot that a group at Sydney University are making, which does mapping of certain areas. In this case, they're using it to map farmlands, do some surveying and stuff. There's a quote you can look it up in that article there, but there's a farmer that says in that quote, like, drones are going to be the most exciting tool in agriculture, like, in the next 20 years, which is pretty cool. Like, we can use drones to plant seeds, or drones to check on crops. There's even robots that make crops for you, or they plant seeds and water them and all that sort of stuff. It's really exciting stuff. drones is one of those things, I think. They're, at the moment, they're like solutions looking for problems. But we already have problems to solve with drones. Really, really cool. We must not forget the goon bag, which was an Australian invention. This is a photo from the Western Australian sculptures by the sea. A giant goon bag. This was an Australian invention. Whatever. I'm not going to go any further than that. The pillow. Yeah. So, and this is just a few of them, right? So I didn't want to go too deep into any of them. Just setting the scene. This is what we do. We're good at this. There's lots more. And this is only a short list that I found. We're really good at this stuff. And we want to get better. And the way that we do that is through proper funding and proper innovation. So that's what we're going to be talking about. Yeah? Awesome. See, that was quick.
I don't know if it's worth putting this on. Thank you, Tom. Our next speaker is Peter Xing. Peter has a Bachelor's of Commerce and Law from Sydney Uni, and he now works as an Innovations Manager at Deloitte. He is passionate about artificial intelligence and biotechnology and all new technologies. He's a leader in the transhumanist and futurist societies in Australia. And he's going to be talking to us about... Hang on. He's going to take us on a tour of Australian innovations. No, that was Tom. Sorry. He's going to talk to us about current and future biotechnology. So please welcome Peter.
Just while I'm setting up, does anyone have any questions for Tom on his Elliot
Doc? Hi everyone. Yes, thanks for the introduction, Eve. So my name is Peter Xing and I work at Deloitte. I'm executive member of the Science Party. So met these guys about a year and a bit long ago, and I was just so excited to see someone actually using evidence-based policies and supporting Australian science and innovation. Not the sort of things that Malcolm Turnbull has been saying, that we're currently in an ideas boom. We need the real funding actually support science, and I'm going to take you through some of those current technologies we've got and the potential we could get to. So, at Deloitte, we talk about, how does innovation work, right? They go, well, you get an idea, you get a laptop, you connect to the internet, and, away you go. Well, how does that all start? So, first, there's got to be the technology trigger, and that's why diffusion of innovation always starts with science. And you see examples of where Moore's Law, for example, you got the silicon chip that goes through this exponential rate of growth, and hence there's a Moore's Law concept that is accelerating with the pace of change. And then innovation happens. People take that technology trigger and apply it to business, different use cases, and make money out of that. So, and once enough people get around to it, that kind of innovation diffuses into the ecosystem, and voila, that's the new normal. And when you get to this new normal, there's a lot of pressure to actually develop new technologies, because once you've saturated that particular technology, everybody's in on it, and it's hard to innovate. So there's this sort of this pressure to invest into R&D. But if we don't do it as Australians, it's going to go to another country. So that's where we're losing a lot of PhD scientists to other countries, where they see that there is this pressure to innovate and to develop new technologies. But if it's not coming out of Australia, then it's we're not going to see it here. And all those little curves you saw is sort of shifting the paradigm. So Moore's Law is coming close to an end, as you see. And this sort of diagram looks at the long-term view of it. So this is called the Law of Accelerating Returns. And it's an extension of Moore's Law, right? So Ray Kurzweil came up with this, is a famous inventor and futurist.
He works at Google as a head of engineering, also head future,
also at the Singularity University as a co-chair. And it says that
throughout history, anything that becomes an information technology doubles, you know, every next number of years. And the accelerating pace of change is happening all the time. We went from the agricultural revolution 8,000 years ago to the Industrial Revolution 120 years ago, to the light bulb just 90 years ago, the moon landing, and then 20 years later, the World Wide Web, and then 9 years, you've got the human genome that's been sequenced. And you see these just different paradigm shifts happening faster and faster. So Moore's Law didn't just start at the silicon chip, we went all the way back to, you know, the 1900s, where, you know, you have these analytical engines, the Colossus, the UniVac, if you remember that, the Apple II. And, you know, Ray Kurzweil, being a futurist and a transhumanist, which is looking at exponential technology, it says that this might lead to the singularity. So I'm going to explain a little bit more about that throughout this talk today. And towards, see, look, there's a mouse there and a human brain there, then there's the collective intelligence and all humanity. So just illustrating how this exponential growth works, you know, in 1975, Steve Sasson, who worked at Kodak, presented to his board and says, look, digital camera and digital imaging is going to be the future. And he comes to it with this, you know, 3.6 kilogram black and white camera on his shoulders and says, look, this is the future. And the board of executives look at it and goes, no, we're Kodak, you know, we make beautiful photos. We're in the paper and oil business of photography. So they shut him down. And then you see, you know, back in a few years ago, Kodak went bankrupt, and Instagram is a $1 billion company acquired by Facebook with only 13 employees. And in 2020, that was back then as 0.01 megapixels. So 2015, you know, everyone's familiar with greater than 10 megapixels, 1,000 times resolution, 1,000 times lighter, and 1,000 times cheaper, because that comes almost as part of your phone. So it's been dematerialized and demonetized. And the human eye, we don't know, but you know, that's 576 megapixels, and you know, it's only a few more doublings before we can get there. And that's what a sort of exponential growth looks like. And I guess Eve mentioned I was really passionate about artificial intelligence because AI is sort of the means of creating these future technologies. If we can replicate what we can do with our minds, then AI will be able to do it far superior than that. I mean, at the moment, you know, we've got a lot of buzz and media and all this dystopic views of AI, but IBM's been spending a lot of money in their marketing team to develop the Watson Group. So they've invested $1 billion into the ecosystem, partnering with the likes of Apple, and doing all these sort of initiatives to get startups to get into the AI business. And one of the things is this cognitive toy, for example, which is just, you know, a Kickstarter. It's a kid can actually have this toy, and it does a question answering. So it learns what the kid's personality is like, and then the kid will ask a question and just uses Wikipedia to tell the answer. And that's the sort of future we're looking towards. And doctors are using this technology to help diagnose patients faster. You know, and AI actually diagnosed a patient that saved their life actually last week. So this stuff is actually mainstream and happening. And they've invested a lot into health analytics, getting the medical data to actually apply it through. And then you got Google's and the other guys essentially got DeepMind Health. They're also looking at into health business. And AlphaGo, you guys seen a lot of the chess champions in. And Adia is the first artificially intelligent-backed hedge fund. So the person who invented it, Ben Goetzel, you know, he might pass away, but this AI fund will continue to trade. It's not rules-based because it learns from the patterns and the training systems. That's where we're heading with that. And this is all powered by a methodology called deep learning. So it's a machine learning sort of methodology. And it learns through layers of features. So it starts with, you know, a computer just sees a bunch of zeros and ones in a digital image. So that's what sort of it sees. But then it looks at these little edges in the image. And once it finds those edges, that's part of that layer. And they call these the neural networks. The next layer, you then look at sort of, you know, these edges all form a part of an eye or, you know, an eyebrow or a bit of a nose. and that's sort of mapped as a layer there. And the next layer of abstraction is the human face, and that's where you have deep face, where you're automatically tagged on Facebook as someone took a photo of you, it automatically recognizes that's Eve right there. So, and they're developing computer hardware to process this deep learning methodology. So this is IBM's neuromorphic chip, and this chip essentially is suited for these kind of algorithms, and you sort of see an explosion of innovation in this field. Applications of artificial intelligence and using these deep learning neural networks is essentially autonomous vehicles. You just saw, I think, it was Ford and Baidu, which is the Chinese Google, investing $150 million to get on the driverless cars. And Google's already worked on it. Tesla's got autopilot, right? So I think, you know, this is going to be pretty mainstream, but the adoption curve is always the issue, right? So 2012, they've already had this sort of testing. It started. Phase one was passive autonomous driving. So you could technically have it, but it might have some accidents and things like that, like what happened at Tesla. Phase two, you've got sort of limited driver substitution. People essentially let it drive. And phase three, from 2018 to 2022, you got complete autonomous capability that, you know, for mass adoption, you know, for all the cars to get upgraded and the whole fleet to get upgraded, you're seeing towards 2025, which is phase four, you know, maybe in a couple of decades, you have 100% sort of autonomous penetration, and it's a utopian society that nobody ever dies of car accidents and things like that. So there's a whole bunch of people working on it right there. I'm really passionate about the future of internet connectivity, because right now there's only about, 3 billion people connected to the internet. If we can get 5 billion out of, or 7.5 billion by 2020, these guys from Facebook, you got internet.org, and Google launching Google Loon project, and SpaceX getting satellites out there to reach out internets. Amazon Prime Air is trying to get some drones out there to do it too. Looking at what we can do. So, virtual and augmented reality is going to fit in, essentially allowing people to connect with each other without having to be physically there. And that's something that we can do for the rest of the world. 3D printing is pretty exciting. It's going to be a $10 trillion industry. So as on, it's going to transform the classrooms, because rather than reading from textbooks, people are just going to actually play around with it in real time. You can 3D print like a Pokemon ball or, other items, in architecture, you can actually 3D print it out there. But what's really exciting is that if you can 3D print organs, then you no longer have to rely on a wait list for transplants. And, a company by the name of Organova is doing this at the moment. There's also other food vendors that's actually 3D printing all their food. So, yeah, it's pretty exciting stuff from there. But take all this with a grain of salt, because there is this thing called the Gartner hype cycle, where you have the innovation trigger. So it might be someone like IBM investing a lot of money in media to get everyone on board with it, and it creates a whole bunch of hype. And then there's a whole bunch of expectations inflated at the top. And once it reaches the top, people realize, oh crap, this doesn't actually do anything. There's no value in this. And all the investment comes booming down, because they're so disillusioned and get this to this trough. But then people take this and they go, oh, actually, there's actually some practical applications to these technologies. And technologies like virtual reality and augmented reality is actually hitting that sort of slope of enlightenment, like Gartner likes to call it, into that plateau of productivity that we might be able to have. And some of these exciting ones that Gartner have outlined is pretty exciting. So you got smart dust. So if you actually print out onto your cars, spray your cars with a particular paint, you can track that particular car's location everywhere. 4D printing is actually printing 3D printed objects, but then letting it be able to be malleable and change the way that you can use it. You got general purpose artificial intelligence or machine intelligence. That's just some really exciting stuff talking towards the singularity. You've got all these brain computer interfaces and a whole bunch of technologies coming on the road. So whether we can actually get that through fully through the curve or not depends on levels of the technology triggers as well, but the innovation side of it. And let's see what the government does with the funding. We can actually reach that. Yeah. The single most exciting part is the future.
Healthcare and longevity.
What is all this technology useful for if it isn't going to improve our
quality of life? And
I think, you know, corporates are onto it as well, because you've got billionaires that are heading up these companies, but they want to live longer and healthier as well. So they've actually invested in things like, in Google Ventures, they've actually invested a whole bunch into life sciences. And they've developed things like partnerships with Novartis, where they're trying to do the sort of contact lenses are smart and tracks your glucose levels and does sort of looking at diabetes. Peter D. Mandis is head of Human Longevity Inc., also co-chair of Singularity University. He's actually developed a company that does, you know, full genome sequencing and whole microbiomes that make sure that you can quantify a particular individual and then allow them to do sort of precision medicine and help them live longer based on their particular traits. You got, you know, guys in Australia like BioFoundry and genomics and things like that. They're actually, you know, my girlfriend actually is running a genomic sequencing company. So, you know, people actually can get onto it. This is the technology trigger out there now. It's a shame we can't have Mia tonight to come and talk about it, but we do have a local community called BioFoundry, and this guy named by the name of Miao Ludo Miao Miao is actually helping citizen scientists run projects to do genomics, looking at particular DNAs and looking at how we can actually do our own science on looking at improving the healthcare. So. So we got this. So CRISPR, this is what really Miao is going to talk about. So what is it? It's a revolutionary genome editing technique that can modify any region of the genome of any species with high precision and accuracy without harming other genes. So this is all the rage at the moment. Yeah, so how did it begin? Back in 1987, there was the first report on how CRISPR works. In 2000, it was founded to be present throughout prokaryotic cells. In 2002, CRISPR, the name was coined. In 2008, CRISPR was found to act upon DNA targets. 2013, there was the first demo of the CRISPR-Cas9 genome editing. So once you've got your full genome sequenced, you can essentially say, well, what's wrong with me? And the more we know that what particular DNA does, or what particular genes does, we can actually do and try to edit it. In 2014, we got genome-wide functional screening with Cas9, and in 2015, cancer cells were actually reversed to normal cells using CRISPR. So this is a brand new world we're heading towards, and you got DIY CRISPR kits that are out there on sale, so people can actually try this themselves. Yeah, that's right. Which is why we need particular policies to have a look at this sort of thing. But so how does it work? So step one, there's a formation of, you know, the editing complex. You got the Cas9 enzyme that pairs with the guide RNA, and it carries the sequence matching that of the target gene. So it's actually a particular protein that tries to get into your DNA there. It's guided through here. You got next one here. It's the pairing with the target gene. So the Cas9 comes here and it targets the DNA at a particular place. So essentially you got, you know, it's the cut and paste tool of the genetics. Yeah. That's when it's actually starts cutting the target DNA, and this is where you insert the new gene. And there we have it. So there's the production of the desired protein, and that's sort of part of your complex. Now, there's actually some people actually doing it themselves at the moment. So BioViva is a company in the US. Liz Parrish is experimenting on herself with these kind of gene therapies. It's actually really just a test if it's, you know, harmful to people or not, and if she's actually doing it herself and trying to inspire the next generation, it's going to be pretty interesting. So what can we do with it? Well, you can delete a gene, so if you've got genetic diseases, you can see if you can actually treat them through gene therapy. You can add a new gene, right, just to see what it does. You know, desirable genes can be added into the genome. It allows them to study the functions. You can activate dead genes, you can do controlling of the gene activity levels. So what does this mean? So human health, right? If we can figure out the actual genetic pathway of improving our healthy lifespans, then this actually is a technique to that. This is the holy grail, right? drug development as well, so everyone reacts differently to different drugs. If we can actually do precision medicine using this method, and a whole bunch of applications in industry, so bioenergy, agriculture, and things like that. So, and this is what's been happening recently. You got Chinese scientists performing the first CRISPR human gene editing trial in August, and we're fighting cancer with gene modifications, and that's been approved for the first human trial as well. So, you know, if we do cover this holy grail, will we have, you know, overpopulation problem? Well, fear not, we look into space. This is the future of space exploration. You've seen the multiple successes that SpaceX has had, relanding their rockets. You've got companies like Deep Space Industries trying to find more resources for us by going out to space and mining asteroids. We're looking at a Mars mission in 2025 for humans. And, you know, companies like Blue Origin, the guys from Jeff Bezos, and that's sort of the future of where we can get more resources of creating this world of abundance. But in order to get there, we do really need some more funding for the sciences. And that's why I'll leave it with James Jansson to talk you through the history of how that's happened.
Thanks, Peter. Our next speaker is James. James has a Bachelor of Science from Sydney Uni as well. That actually probably met him possibly in this room, also studying science. And he's also studied education. He's taught science to high school students. He's got a PhD in HIV modelling, mathematical modelling of HIV, and he's now working in a startup that is his startup, TapView, and he's the leader of the science party and our founder. So over to you, James. Talk about that.
Yeah. Thank you, everyone, for coming along to Science Week. I thought it was really important to hold an event in Science Week for the Science Party. Science Week is a great opportunity to talk about culture and the relevance, scientific research and its relevance to culture. And so this is a really great opportunity to talk about the place of Science Party in our society in terms of getting the outcomes that we desire. So I'm going to talk a bit about sort of the history of science and what we mean by things like moonshots. So a moonshot is a technology in a context that is ambitious, exploratory, groundbreaking, project undertaken without any expectation of near-term profitability or benefit, and also perhaps without full investigation of potential risks and benefits. Moonshots are big, they're scary, they're uncertain. They have huge potential, and that's why they're so interesting. So I'm going to talk about where the inspiration for the name came from. It came from the Apollo 11 mission, which was the landing of humans on the moon. So that happened in 1969, but it wasn't just something that happened in 1969. It was an enormous undertaking. So it was first announced by JFK in 1962. This is his famous speech where he says, I think it's, we choose to go to the moon and do these other things, not because it's easy,
but because it's hard.
Is that what it is?
Yeah.
Got sold. But it was a big event. No one had ever done anything like this. Just think about what it's like to be in that time. No one had been to another planet before. Like, the concept is completely foreign to every single person on the Earth. And it took a lot of time. There was a huge amount of political change that happened
in the period that led up to the landing on the moon. So JFK was assassinated in 1963.
Then there was President Johnson, up until 1969 in January, and then Nixon took office. It was two rounds of presidents later before you even achieved the goal that JFK set out. So this was a huge undertaking without being able to see the benefits in that single political sitting, in that term for that government. It also took an enormous amount of money. So this was the NASA budget during that period, and as you can see in the 1960s, NASA was taking close to 5% of the federal budget. 5%. So one in every $20 that the taxpayer was giving to the government was going to put a person or three people on the moon. That's an enormous amount of money. And in terms of the Australian budget, our budget in 2016 was $450 billion. 5% of that would be $22.5 billion. So that would be like asking every single person in this country to put $1,000 each towards putting someone on the moon. Lots of people would like to do it, but you have to do it through tax. You have to do it through force, and you have to inspire the whole population to get behind this idea. That moonshot was an extremely risky and expensive and time-consuming undertaking. So I'm going to talk about some of the qualities of moonshots. So what I think they are is not all moonshots have to have these qualities, but they have at least some of them. So they're large cost, large scale, large impact, and they have highly uncertain outcomes. So firstly, large cost. Here's a couple of recent large cost moonshots. We have the Large Hadron Collider, which was $9 billion, and it has, I think it's $1 billion per year operating budget. We did this to observe a particle, basically, or a few particles. You're talking about $10 billion to look at a particle. But it's really important, because if we don't do this, we don't understand the universe. And we could, by refusing to fund something like this, we could miss out on the next step of science to advance our society. The International Space Station is another example of it. It's been going for a lot longer than the Large Hadron Collider, used to perform low-gravity experiments and do other things, observational experiments and stuff like that. Total cost since its inception is $150 billion. Now, the budget has blown out from that. It's another one of those uncertainties of moonshots that you don't know how much you need to spend in order to achieve your goal. But that's an enormous cost, but an extremely valuable resource for the world. In addition to being large cost, moonshots are large scale. So this is Fermilab. It is a gigantic circle with superconducting magnets buried beneath the ground, which is another one of these particle smashes, accelerating atoms and other particles in a big loop to find out about the universe. But what's really interesting about this is the size of it. It's 6.4 kilometers around. So because of the size of the experiment, it's necessarily expensive. And this is something that happened in post-war science, where we had the industrialization that happened out of World War II is being transferred over to the scientific field. You can produce lots of really big things with precise measurements to perform these really difficult experiments at a very large scale. I like this term. It's called big science. It's like you're doing experiments that are gigantic. I just love it. Anyway, the other part of it is that it has a large or possibly exponential impact. So what I mean by that is that it greatly improves our understanding of the universe. So if it's general relativity, if it's these particles that we need to understand, like it improves our knowledge about the universe. It could improve our quality of life greatly. So if it makes us more longer lived, if it improves our wealth, if it reduces disease, this is, you know, one of these large impacts that a moonshot can have. It inspires a new generation of scientists. So the NASA program made everyone in the United States talk about science and engineering. And it positioned a new generation of people to be inspired about science. So when you do these big moonshot projects, people get inspired by them. And we haven't really had a lot of them in Australia. And, you know, something that we don't get to do that a lot of Americans do get to do is go to a space, go to NASA. They get to go to NASA. They get to go to space camp. And that's really like a fun way to get introduced to a lot of the things that are done in science and to make people see the connection between government funding and the science that we do. We do have Questacon in Canberra, but it's not quite the same as going to NASA. So, the next thing about the large impact is that the knowledge that we get can be built upon. So, like, it doesn't solve just a problem today. It sets us up to solve more problems in the future. So, some examples of like large impact moonshot science. This is Edward Jenner. He's pretty famous because at the time smallpox was killing 400,000 people per year in Europe at the end of the 18th century. That's an enormous amount of people. That's like 1/10 of Sydney dying every single year in Europe. Edward Jenner isn't the last person to do research on this. There are a few discoveries that were made earlier to that. But basically, he developed the smallpox vaccine by taking cowpox and inoculating people with it. And in doing so, well, he was a biohacker, the first biohacker, maybe not the first biohacker. The first biohacker was probably the person who invented beer. So that was a very good invention as well, a huge moonshot. We can talk about how important that was to civilized society later. But the result of this work was, you know, we discovered that it prevented smallpox. And with that piece of information, we could not just apply it to the people that Edward Jenner knew. We could apply it to everyone in the world. And we did, and there's no more smallpox as a result of that. So, another person who's pretty high impact. Once again, Einstein isn't the end or the beginning of a lot of this research. But Einstein, he came up with the theory of special relativity, which is extremely important to modern physics. He came up with some of the important elements of quantum physics, and that is basically that light is quantized. So that gave us like some knowledge which is really, really useful. So for things like the photoelectric effect, which has led to solar panels, which looks like it's going to be one of the primary ways that we're going to power our world in the next 50 or so years. In addition to that, that, you know, helped us with things like computer chips and stuff like that. He also came up with general relativity. And that is pretty important because it helps us do things like correct GPS calculations. But essentially, the total contribution to humanity is, you know, if you add up, solar power, GPS, all the advancement in terms of our knowledge about computers and what's the total contribution to humanity? We don't even know. It would be in the trillions by now, but this knowledge will power us into the future even further. I'm sure that general relativity is not even being used anywhere near 1% of how much we'll use it in, you know, the next 1,000 years or so. So the next element of moonshots, which I think is really important to talk about, is highly uncertain outcomes. So what is the net payout for putting money into research? So with cancer, we can tell what the outcome is. You know, we can measure the amount of people who die from cancer, the expected number of people in the future, work it all out. The problem is, so you could say, you know, we can save 1 million people per year if we cure this particular type of cancer. The problem is that we don't know how much research it will take to actually cure that cancer. It could be discovered by accident in a lab, or it could be a disease that eludes us for 20 years. So that's an example where you have a clear outcome but an unclear cost. When it comes to new theories of physics or mathematics, what is the outcome that you're looking for? How much quality of life can we improve? You know, how much computer power will that give us? How close will that make the next star?
In terms of
traveling distance in our lifetimes, we have absolutely no idea what money we're giving to, you know, the undergraduate and postdoctoral, the doctoral students of today will result in 50 years' time. It's completely unclear. So, and in order to make the next discovery, in order to discover the next particle, in order to discover, you know, why the universe behaves in a strange way, you know, over in that area that we've just looked at, we don't know how long or how much money it will take to discover that. So it's very, very uncertain. The other thing about funding moonshot activities, things with big costs and like big outcomes, is we don't know if now is the right time. So like the way that big science came out of the Second World War, post-industrialization, that sort of huge boom in industry, we may not have the technology right now to do the research that we want to do. So there might be a lot of very incremental science and incremental technological development that we need to do in the meantime before we take on the next big thing. You know, so if we want to discover the next particle, do we need to do more research into superconductivity first in order to build, you know, a more efficient particle collider or something like that? It's hard to make this decision because the economic outcome is also uncertain. So this is a hard decision to make. You can't justify it with evidence-based policy, unfortunately. I know that we love to talk about this in the science party, but if there's one thing that you learn about finance, if you've ever studied it, is that past returns is no indicator of future success. And so although we can look at science and we can say, well, if we put money into science, we make all these discoveries and look at the payoff. And you could say, yes, that's true. The more we put money in, the more returns we get back. But what is the dollar return that we put in? Like if we put in a dollar now, is it going to be 10 times? Is it going to be 4 times? Is it going to be 2 times? Or is it going to be like a complete loss on a particular project? And so we can't actually use economics to justify the level of spending that we put in beyond looking at history and saying, well, we did lots of good in the past, so we should try and keep doing that until we possibly hit a wall. So this is a list of moonshot fields that I think is generally where we're likely to go, and areas where I think we could drop in some money and have really big impacts in uncertain projects. So mathematics, physics, medical science, so looking at diseases with high mortality. We have 120,000 people who die per year in Australia, largely from disease. So if we could drop a bit of money into that, let's say bring down mortality only by half. And we've done that. We did that from 1987 to 2007. The mortality rate between the ages of 45 and 60 dropped by half. And that was a really high mortality range for that age group. And we dropped it by half in 20 years. So I think putting money into high mortality diseases, one of these moonshot fields that we should be looking at. large-scale transportation systems. This one is an interesting one. It's very hard to know what the next invention will be. When I started the science party, we had a policy on high-speed rail, and now Elon Musk is talking about Hyperloop. Now, I have a very, well, my eye is skeptical on that one. I don't know that having a gigantic vacuum stretched over several hundred kilometers with the potential for tectonic plates ripping apart and then, you know, the wind gushing in and, you know, shooting people out like bullets at the other end is necessarily a great idea. I think it's going to cost a lot more than what he says it's going to cost. But that concept of having an evacuated tube with a cart that flies within it like it's flying in space just didn't exist in 2013. So if we say, if we say in 2013 we should do this, there's a risk that there's an invention just around the corner that could make it obsolete before you even complete the project. But at the same rate, large-scale transportation systems are very good for connecting people and making the world a smaller place. Computational research, so extending our knowledge about the logic and understanding of how to produce efficient algorithms. AI research, I think, will be extremely big and have huge payoffs. Integrated circuit research. So in the last year, we've had Samsung has produced 16 terabyte SSD drives. And now that's at a point where regular platter hard drives can't keep up anymore. And that's because they did research into multi-layer storage on their NAND chips. So if we can put more money into that, maybe we could have, you know, another order of magnitude increase in computational power in only a few years. In addition to that, we've got quantum computing. It's pretty interesting. That one's probably a lot further off than most people would like to imagine, I'd say. Interplanetary travel, we're seeing this already, through SpaceX. The one thing that people don't realize about SpaceX, though, is that it is actually largely government funded. So they're doing contracts for NASA and various other national security organizations. They get their money from government, it keeps them alive, and in order to do more interplanetary travel, we're going to have to use government funding to do it, because there's actually not a lot of value to private companies in doing planetary exploration. The law around space travel, owning stuff in space, is that you can't mine it at the moment. That's the convention. All stuff in space, you're not allowed to mine it. So despite the fact that we have, you know, space mining companies around, if they're from a country that's part of that convention, they're not actually allowed to take it and use it and stuff like that. They're not actually allowed to claim a space on the moon as being belonging to a company or a country. Need money for that from the government. And energy research. So we've had a lot of energy research. I think people really underestimate the enormous amount of money that went into solar panel research, right from, you know, the 70s up until recently. You know, more and more research has been put into it, but it's been an enormous amount. And there's a lot of research that we could be doing into other fields. So nuclear fusion is an example of that, where it's a gigantic moonshot operation. You have to build a gigantic reactor. They have a program going in Europe at the moment. It's the sort of thing which possibly we could do if we wanted to spend $1,000 per person every year for a few years in Australia, but it's likely something that we'd want to collaborate with other countries on. So what makes it hard to get funding for this stuff? These are enormously long-term payoffs, especially for things like theoretical physics, mathematics, and things that can't be patented. you know, we have to take the societal benefit to it, which is, you know, that we have more people alive. Like, what's the value of a child's life being saved right now for them to become a worker in 18 years' time? That's, you know, many, many governments later that you actually get the payoff for it. So, you know, you're taking a huge political risk, spending money now to get the results later. And so in many cases, you have the workers of today who are paying taxes to do research that they don't see the benefit of. Hopefully we can fix that. Hopefully we can bring about some of the life-preserving research that Peter Singh likes to talk about. But while people are running under the assumption that they live to about 83, anything that takes about 50 years means that people who are in the prime of their working lives being taxed at the highest level in their 40s and 50s will never see the results of that research. So you have to convince people to do good things. I think there's a saying about the sign of an advanced civilization is old people planting trees. That's what we need to convince people to do, that we need to take money now with the risk that you'll never see the payoff in the future. So how do we make Australia a moonshot nation? So firstly, we need to get people to understand the benefits of science, the benefits of doing this research. I think that there's a lot of people, including members of our own government, who don't understand the value of scientific research. If they did understand it, they wouldn't be cutting it so much. So we need to build a culture of science being fundamental to our society. So we need to be telling people that to be an Australian, excuse the nationalism, to be an Australian is to be scientifically minded, is to be proud of Australian scientific advancements. You know, and it doesn't have to be necessarily Australian, but it needs to be like, people need to have a way of expressing their affinity for science and identifying with it and making it part of their persona and being proud of it. So we need to build up that culture in our society. And we need to make science part of the political conversation in Australia. And that's part of the reason why we created the Future Party and then now called the Science Party. So yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you, James. And our next speaker is Andrea Leong. Andrea writes a lot of the policy for the Science Party. She has a PhD on, looking at technologies to prevent infections from surgical implants. And she's now working for a private research lab looking at medical cannabinoids. I should have practiced that word. And the effect of the microbiome on body systems. So thank you, Andrea. Thank you.
All right, thanks very much, Eve. Is there a clip on this? No. Cool. Yes, as Eve mentioned, I did my PhD on looking at a surface coating on the molecular scale for surgical implants, like hip replacements or whatever, to stop the implant from becoming infected, so something that's antibacterial and also induces the body's own tissues to accept the implant as part of itself, which we call cytocompatibility. And that was, I finished up my experiments at the end of last year and handed my thesis in April. And it's a testament to the pace of science that this sort of technology is already becoming superseded by things like stem cell technology and 3D printing of biological scaffolds to induce the body to regrow missing or lost parts of itself. So I'm the policy officer of the Science Party, and I'm very interested in whether governments are keeping up with these kind of advances and supporting these advances in science and technology. So one thing that governments need to do is to create the right conditions for good science to be done. So I'll talk a bit about this, and then I'll talk a bit about science, the Science Party's policies and how we're trying to address these issues. So something that scientists need to be able to do good science is to have freedom of communication, because science is an iterative process. You can only build upon the last success or failure. And I should mention it's very important and underrated to report negative results there. And in fact, I shouldn't call them failures. Negative results have a bit of a bad rap in science. And it's very difficult to get negative results published, but that tells us the way that we don't want to keep going. And if we can get these results published, it will increase the efficiency of science, because scientists will no longer be banging their head against that same brick wall. But more importantly, or perhaps more something that governments can do, is to allow freedom of communication between scientists. So recently, Canadian researchers were effectively gagged from talking about much of their findings with the media. So, sorry, that's researchers with Canadian government agencies. Anytime they were going to speak to the press, what they were going to say had to be vetted so that they presumably would not say anything that was politically inconvenient. This included climate scientists and agricultural scientists. So that's a little bit scary that the public has to, for some reason, it's thought that the public needs to be shielded from what should be good results of good experiments. And here in Australia, we have a recent piece of legislation known as the Defence Trade Controls Act. And I'm actually trying to find a bit more information on this. It's a little bit hard to, it's pretty opaque, but it criminalises providing goods, services, that sort of thing, to anyone who might use those goods or services in a manner that contradicts national security. So when no one's really sure what this extends to, but it might even include, say, a computer scientist, a computer science professor teaching encryption to students, and then if one of those students then decides they want to become a terrorist and they encrypt their communications, we really don't know if that sort of activity would be criminalised under this. So this is something we need a lot more clarity on, because it's got a lot of scientists quite worried. And scientists also need the other sort of freedom of communication, which is access to publications and journal articles. So a lot of journal articles are behind paywalls. And it's been said that some of these journal companies, like Elsevier, who manage access to a lot of scientific publications, their practices make the mainstream media look like a charitable service with the amounts that they charge. So you might have come up against paywalls when you're trying to read something, some scientific research. Say you want to read something from the journal Science. You can log in if you're lucky enough to be part of an institution that subscribes to it, or you can pay, this one was $30 for one day's access, and then the file will no longer open. You can pay $79 if you want to read something from this journal, but at least I guess you get to keep it forever. And that sort of thing really stifles the advancement of science for anyone who can't afford to subscribe to these sorts of services. And even if they can, it's a drain on university funding if they have to be subscribing for thousands of dollars every year to all these services when they could be spending that money on research instead. And that's why some very naughty people have set up a website which I obviously make no recommendations either way as to whether you should visit to see the journal articles that they put up there for free. All right, so what else can governments do? Science is best undertaken in a context of political stability, and I'm not just talking about violent conflicts. Even the recent exit of Britain from the EU has had some consequences. I've read about a physicist from the University of Manchester who has been dropped from a collaboration with European collaborators because they weren't sure about the types of resources or perhaps even the IP that they would be able to share with the rest of the collaborators. So that's one unfortunate effect of political instability and uncertainty. And we can only hope that it doesn't impact upon the British scientists who are working on ITER, which is the nuclear fusion research project that James was talking about. So that's based in France, I think, and there are British scientists working on that. So hopefully that won't hinder that research. Funding, which is what we're here to talk about. Funding is another and very important way in which governments can support research. Is the Australian government funding science adequately? Not in OECD terms. So on the left here is the government spending on research and development as a percentage of GDP. So here's Australia, nearly at the bottom. And up the top, South Korea is spending three times more of its national budget on R&D. When we look at the graph on, on the right, that is government spending plus private industry spending. So Australia's moving up the order a bit there. So that means that private industry is picking up the slack. And that's a great thing. But when private industry is doing the majority of research funding, there is a chance that it's going to skew the type of research to a particular type of science. And that's not the science we've been talking about. It's not the high cost, very long-term payoff. It's going to be more likely to be projects that pay off more quickly in the short term, which is great, as I said, but it's only half the picture, and it's the second half of the picture. The first picture is the basic science, and that is the sort of science that governments need to be supporting with funding. Now, in Australia, government funding is given in the form of competitive grants. So it's a great irony that the longer you spend in the field of science, the less time you spend in the lab or whatever your field might be, and you spend basically all of February writing grants, from what I understand. So that's how scientists spend a lot of their time, is trying to get money for their projects. And even if they're good projects, it doesn't mean they're going to get funded. The NHMRC, National Health and Medical Research Council, and the ARC, Australian Research Council, currently only fund 15% of grant applications, even though many more, about half, are deemed fundable or good ideas. So that's a testament to the amount of science that could be done if we could fund it more. There is more science to be done. There is always more science to be done. And there's also a problem in the way that we assess these grants. Grant applications, or the assessors, really favour scientists' track records. This is a bit of a side point, but it's not just the merit of the idea. Assessors look at whether you've published in journals and how impactful those journals are. And this leads scientists to engage in, you know, it's scientists to humans too, and they will do what they can to maximise their returns from the system. And if the system is favouring a track record, they'll engage in grant hacking, which means having ghost authors, which is even if a younger junior researcher has the idea, they'll put on a senior researcher who has a track record of publishing a lot of high impact papers, and maybe even the younger researchers who contributed to the grant project idea will be left off. So that does nothing for their career. So once you get on the, once you get a grant, you keep getting more and more grants. And if they're off, if they're not on that initial grant, then they're still officially not, they don't have a grant to their name. Another thing is that the assessors tend to look at whether you've been invited to speak at a conference. And within science, there is a group of scientists that routinely are less often invited to speak, and that's women. So that's another way that there's bias brought in by the grant system. So funding science inadequately is bad for science directly, because we're doing less science than we could be doing. It's also bad indirectly because it reduces diversity in science, and that also is bad for science. All right, so I'm going to talk now a little bit about science party policy and what we're trying to do to improve the science situation in Australia. So these are our policy areas, and it's quite broad, but a theme of science being what improves our lives runs through all of our policy areas. So for instance, in the transportation policy, we have a policy of allowing driverless car testing in Australia to keep up with these new technologies. And in our regional Australia policy, we also, for a long time, had a policy of allowing farmers to use more drones on their properties to, you know, to work their land. So that's something that has been implemented at least partway. CASA, the aviation authority, has reduced the restrictions, and that's something that we preempted. So I'm only going to talk about these first three policies. Obviously, our science and research policy is quite relevant, but I'll also just touch on our space policy and our education policy as well tonight. So a few points from our science and research policy. We recently added a point that we want to have a minister for science and research. You wouldn't think that you'd need to, but in 2013, for a short while, we had no science minister after decades of having one, which was bizarre, actually. And now we do, but it's in the same portfolio as the industry minister. So we have a science and industry minister. So we also want to have a separate minister for innovation and industry, because these are separate areas, they're separate sectors, they have different aims, and we think they should be represented by different portfolios in Parliament. And also having these things, these positions in Cabinet, sends a signal to the Australian people that science and research and innovation and industry are important. We also want to double research funding. So as you saw on that graph, we currently spend 0.4% of our GDP on government-funded science. We want to double this to at least 0.8%. And of course, we get the question all the time, how are you going to pay for it? But as James mentioned, science, investing in science and research and technological development pays dividends. They're not immediate. In fact, they can be very long-term, and they're very difficult to quantify, but it brings money back into the economy in the long-term, so it pays for itself. And I just want to share an example of some researchers in Newcastle who are working on a helium atom microscope. So this is a new type of optical... Is that the right word? It's a new type of microscopy. So it allows us to look at materials in a new way, and it's going to allow us to make advances in materials faster than we have in the past. And it's this group has received $2 or $3 million in funding to date, and they've still got a little bit to go, but... And unfortunately for them, the returns are not going to show up on their budget sheet. But the returns are going to come much later down the track in the materials research that their technology allows. So this is the sort of research projects that are being funded and we need to fund more of. So that's one of the success stories of Australian research funding at the moment. We also have priority areas, and we don't think a government should shy away from that. We're big supporters of the CRCs, which are collaborative research projects of targeted grants in certain national priority areas, which aim to link academic research with industry. And they do a lot of great work in primary industries and materials, advanced manufacturing research, which that obviously has a lot of commercialisable applications, but they also do biomedical research and contributed to the cochlear project and safer contact lenses. We also have a priority to look into nuclear energy, which can be a bit of a controversial one. We're not saying let's build current generation fusion reactors right now, but we really need to have a conversation about nuclear energy. It has risks, of course, but we need to stop burning coal. Contrary to what some One Nation senators might think, climate change is a very real and pressing question for humanity. So it would be irresponsible for us to not include nuclear technology, especially fusion, in the conversation about our energy needs for the future. So our next policy area is space, and that used to be part of our science and research policy, but we popped it out recently and expanded it. So Tom worked on that a lot, also with our Victorian candidate, Luke James, and also Peter Aylward, who's the president of the Australian Space Society? Association.
The acronym would be funny if it was Australian Space Society.
That's an American word, James. Yes, so in the first instance, we would like to establish an Australian Space Agency. And projects regarding going to space often get a lot of criticism. People say, why do you want to go into space when we have so many problems to solve right here on Earth? But it's always been the case that space research has brought about all sorts of technologies that we use here on Earth to solve our problems here on Earth. So space research is research for all of us. We want to incentivise Australian space infrastructure and undertake a space innovation and growth strategy study, because we want to get advice from the experts on this, because we listen to the experts. Now, and the final policy area I'm going to talk about is education. So this is how we're going to bring up a new generation of scientists. So we want to see more and better STEM subject teaching, that's science, technology, engineering and maths. I'm surprised that acronym hasn't come up tonight yet. More and better STEM teaching by specialised teachers throughout primary and secondary schools, mandatory mathematics and science all through high school. And that includes computer programming from an early age, probably from late primary school, because I think it's been said that once a child understands that one thing is greater than another, they're able to start computer programming. We also want to push scientific literacy and critical thinking in schools, because this is the way that Australians, well, all people, whether or not they go into a science or technology field, are able to know and understand the benefits of science, and also tell fact from fiction. I think there is a disturbing trend at the moment to go against authority simply because it's there, and we should not blindly accept the things that people say just because they say them, and in fact that sort of scepticism is part of critical thinking. But it's a very dangerous, some dangerous ideas coming in, and like denying the denial of climate change and denial of vaccines are some strange ideas that have taken off, and they just seem to be pushing against scientific authority just for the sake of it.
But scientists, let me tell you, scientists live to prove each other wrong. So there is no way, there's not
enough money in the world to pay off all scientists to cover up a vaccine conspiracy or a conspiracy about climate change. So if all the scientists are finding the same results, it means there's a very strong preponderance of evidence in that direction. We also want to make tertiary education affordable for all Australians, and that includes vocational education training, so the sorts of courses that are done at TAFE. And when it comes to university, that means we also don't want to make any changes to HECS. Well, ideally we would have free university education, and it's been done in the past, but we don't want to make university less affordable, because we should be moving forwards, not backwards. And we also want to support higher degrees by research. It's a strange situation that we've got, that a lot of the PhD graduates that do their studies in Australia don't go into academia when they finish. And that's just because the jobs aren't there. So I see a lot of people do PhDs, whether they're local or whether they come here from overseas. When they finish, if they can't find an academic job, if they're from overseas, they'll have to go back home, often reluctantly, because they've been here for 4 years. And people who are locals often go overseas. In fact, one of our executive members is in Sweden at the moment, because that's where he was able to get the best job in mathematics research. So we have this, as I said, a strange situation where there are many more PhD graduates than there are positions for these graduates. And one solution that's suggested is to reduce the number of PhD scholarships. I would say this is, again, going backwards instead of forwards. I think it's never a problem to have people highly educated. What we need to do is to manage people's expectations as they go through a PhD, that they won't necessarily go into academia, that there are positions also in industry. They might also go on to a field outside the area that they studied in. But also, if we have too few positions for them in academia, why not try to increase the positions that we have? Because, as I said, there's always more research to be done, and there are always more people wanting to do that research. And just to bring it around, that's what we're trying to do in the Science Party, trying to bring the conversation around to funding science better so that we can have more and better science. And that's the end of my presentation. Thank you.
So do all the speakers want to come up and field some questions? There's a question there.
Especially listening to the last talk, I find it very interesting. I find at the end of the talk, I agree with a lot of the policy, but the earlier part of the talk, I thought was a little bit wishy-washy on top. I think the Science Party has got to avoid being sort of too wishy-washy and nice, and also from standing handing out pamphlets on the polling station. We don't want to be just another subsidy party. You know, there's nationals who stand for subsidies to the rural people, there's big xenophon subsidies for South Australia and Jackson Lambie and so on. The Science Party has to give a message beyond just spending money on spending government money, spending taxpayer money on science. It has to embrace changes to policy, changes to ideas which are not necessarily spending money. But the other thing about the talk, this idea that the science, you know, what about Brexit and so on, that we need this harmonious sort of wonderland. The best science has come out of conflict and come out of areas of great change. We talked about rocket science, which came out of the Second World War and the Wernher von Braun and so on. The space program came out of the intense competition between Russia and America, and people being incentivized to go beyond their, you know, their normal abilities. A lot of the wonderful advances that you talked about came from very driven individuals, you know, people like Steve Jobs and Musk and so on, who are in a very anarchic, competitive environment. And I just think we shouldn't necessarily kind of gloss over it and make it all nice. And the final thing is, you know, Steve Jobs always used to say there was a link between science and the humanities sort of thing, which tried to present, and we don't want to be an anti-humanities party while being pro-science. Just a big one.
So just the point about conflict and its relationship to science spending, I think that there were a lot of amazing things done in science as a result of the increased spending on the military. But the problem is that the actual spending on the science itself is a proportion of the total spending on the military operations was tiny. It was really, really, really small. So, like, when you look at the net value of what happened in those wars, you'd be much better off just giving all that money back to people, having all those people who died still actually being alive and paying taxes and doing science themselves in some cases, than to actually just say, well, let's go to war or allow going to war. Yeah, I guess what's it's hard to do science when you've got bombs falling on you. And a lot of the really good German scientists actually ended up in the United States as a result of what happened in World War II. And that's like one of the things that we like to talk about is like advancing society in the context of democracy and peace. It's really important to make sure that people's lives are happy and stable, and they have some control over that. And that's where we're coming from in respect to Brexit. Not necessarily that Brexit is great, or bad or whatever it is. There's lots of good things and bad things about the European Union. But for the record, we are very pro-migration. Migration is extremely important to scientists. When you have over a third of my graduating class from physics being in Europe right now, the reason why that's possible is because the Europeans think Australian passports are okay. And you see what happens, you know, it's happened generation after generation. You had coffee houses in particular cities in Europe where, like, physicists and mathematicians would come together and actually discuss things. And what would have happened if we had a fence around every single one of those countries?
Easy migration of scientists, I agree with you.
Yeah, exactly. So, yeah, that's one of the downsides to Brexit, is the potential impact on migration.
Okay. I love the sort of you mentioned about the billionaires doing it on themselves and industry. I think the industry is great, and I talked about how innovation takes over once you have that technology trigger. But I think it's when the risk isn't quantified, it's hard for corporations and industry to explore that. So space was initially a government funded initiative. Once that risk had been quantified, commercial guys
come in
and take over and make great products.
I think governments could do the pure science and the more anything else.
We might move on to a question here.
Peter, you like to talk about the singularity.
Yes.
Which people like to talk about, but very few people actually specify what they say it is supposed to be. And it was believed it was John von Neumann who first proposed the concept and where it became popularized, did not Ray Kurzweil.
That's right.
He just wrote a good book.
He did.
You know, I mean, it's that point where you no longer can predict the future, even down to what's going to happen next week. Because you have, at that point, created an artificial intelligence that is human-level intelligence. That's not a goal. That's going to be a milepost where it's
that's right. Bias, right.
So why put funding into anything else? Because once you invent the human-level artificial intelligence, all the scientists can go home.
That's why I'm so passionate about it. So we can essentially duplicate every single scientist that we ever know and some. Right, yeah. Artificial general intelligence.
It's a very creepy concept.
It's what makes STEM.
It redefines everything. Why have grade school children learning programming when they be no jobs or programmers within 30 or 40 years?
That's a challenge. Yeah.
We're not there yet. Like, in order to get to that level, if we do.
Because people want to do this. It's very cool. I mean, they asked a lot of the atomic scientists working on the Atomic Manhattan Project, and you know, I mean, they're motivated a lot by the times, but also because it was the most exciting thing they ever did. And this is what these researchers in AI are doing. Without a few people are thinking about it, but it could.
I don't know,
change
to me,
that
sounds to me a little bit like people who are like, oh, well, why do we need to legalize gay marriage when there's all of these other problems? That you can think about lots of problems at the same time, and there's tractable problems that we might be able to solve, like, in September.
I want to go home. AI is going to have to keep me out of the lab.
I'm not going to be, I will be here by then, but I don't want to think of human beings just being taken care of by robots.
Right? The thing is that intelligence isn't fully understood. So what we've seen over the past couple of decades with artificial intelligence research is that the goalposts keep getting moved. So when you find out, it's like, we're going to reach true artificial intelligence as soon as a computer can beat us at chess. This gets redefined. It's like, oh, actually, it's not really. This happened several times already. It could just be we don't have a really good understanding of what intelligence is, and maybe it is actually what we understand intelligence to be is unique to humans.
It's like the driverless car thing. 10 years ago, nobody even dreamed about it. And now it comes with every Tesla sold. It's already here.
Yeah, but not necessarily an artificial intelligence.
It's just that this,
it's going to be a great conversation.
Yeah.
Okay.
From my point of view, I think people actually want to be more competitive, right, to stay relevant and get jobs and things like that. So I think, which is why I'm a transhumanist, because I think people are going to augment their own intelligences. And I think because we have a working model up here, we already have a way to sort of find ways to bridge that with the internet. And you see Elon Musk talking about a neural lace, right? If someone doesn't build it, he might. But he needs government funding on that side too, right? So that's something we can say for the public as well.
Okay. I might take – this is the last question. And after this, there'll be plenty more opportunity to really let loose.
My question was about scientists and how they interact with regulators, because I think that's an area which we as scientists really kind of ignore, and the regulators seem to not have any eye on the future until it comes to bite them, and then they're kind of retrofitting regulations to think, and self-driving cars is a great example, because insurance companies are now trying to figure out, okay, well, when these cars get into accidents, who's the payer and where does the liability lie? And similar things, you know, organ 3D printing, when that organ goes, like something happens inside, how are we engaging with the people who are going to be making those defining boundaries around how we use all these technologies?
Join the science party.
Yeah.
You become a member of the science party at scienceparty.org.au, and you can help actually shape the policies as this technology is rapidly coming.
When we become regulators as well.
I had first-hand experience of working as a scientist with regulators. I used to work at the National Measurement Institute, where in the legal metrology
policy office, right? So metrology is the study of measurement, and it was the legal version of that, right? So every measurement is traced back to a physical thing or a fundamental constant, science-wise, like physically. And also in legal metrology, everything is traced back legally through bits of papers, right? So physicists and scientists use instruments to measure the kilogram, but lawyers and politicians use instruments to give to courts, right? That's their instrument. The language is completely different. So it's really difficult to talk about science to regulators because they just talk different language. An example, the perfect example, is when as scientists we rely on uncertainty and, you know, and error in measurements. I cannot tell you that, you know, I was driving down the highway at 110 kilometers an hour because it's 110 plus or minus something. But as soon as you say that to a lawyer or a regulator, they say, well, if you're uncertain about that, what else are you uncertain about? Right? Different language. And it's clear that science moves faster than policy. But if we can talk about this culture thing where we lift up the culture so that politicians also have that same language, it's a functional language, right? We need to speak science, they need to speak law, that's fine. But if we can kind of combine it a little bit through that culture shift, that culture change, then at least we're speaking some of the same
and have
way.
The conversations now while the singularity is still...
So you saw what happened on Q&A. Brian Cox had a graph, right? But it's a NASA conspiracy, right? So we can't even have that conversation. That's why we're here. We're trying to have that conversation.
On specific regulations, so as part of the innovation policy, the startup policy for the Science Party, we put in a policy which is to review laws to make sure that they're, you know, not unnecessarily hindering, you know, the advancement of society. So, you know, that's one thing that you could do. You could do regular reviews of laws, have, you know, the... It sounds like I'm saying that Tony Abbott is a good parliamentarian, but they had a review of certain laws and they got rid of a whole heap of laws, which is useful because a lot of laws are very old.
To remember, regulators are not just about hindrance, they're about protection as well. Mm. And I think we have to have that balanced approach because there are instances where science has run away and no one's been there to kind of, you know, I mean, there's heaps of medicines out there, you can use so many examples. So if we are going to approach them with a biased view, then we're going to bias the whole society's view towards these guys who really aren't there to make, I mean, they're kind of there to make everyone's life hard, but they're also there to, you know, look after the larger good or, you know, so we have to have respect for that as well. And have that balanced approach.
Absolutely. And we do have technology that's coming up that could be very good or very scary. So the advances in CRISPR, for example, backyard genetics, sounds great until someone creates something that kills off a good portion of humanity. So how do you regulate that? How do you make sure that we don't accidentally create an AI
maybe
that
it's just evolution in action.
Does stuff? Yeah, well, maybe that's why we have the Fermi paradox. But you know, so we gotta we do have to have checks and balances, so making sure that the legislation is up to date is important.
I was at a low SES school today talking to high school year 7 to 10 students, but year 9 students in particular, it was in the afternoon, they hadn't, you know, they needed a break, but they hadn't had one yet. They were feral kids, right? Low SES, they weren't really into it, but they were asking exactly the same question about AI. I showed them a picture of a robot being pushed over, and the first question is, wow, what happens when the robot gets brains to say, don't do that anymore?
Yeah.
Right? Yeah. These are the ethical problems that they're going to have to deal with. And these kids, they did not want to know about science, yet as soon as I showed them the video, they're into it. They want to do it. They want to know about it.
Yeah, cool.
All right, we might wrap up now. So is it the Duckin?
No, the Rose.
The Rose. We're about to head to the Rose Pub, which is
Cleveland Street,
if you get lost, or we'll kind of walk in a group. Pardon?
Shepherd
and Cleveland Street, yeah. Encourage you all to come along and just keep chatting. There's also a science party. We just have a monthly meeting every month, and our monthly meeting is next Thursday in the city if you're interested. just come and ask us or find the details on the internet. So we'd love to see new faces. And thank you all for coming. And thank you, let's thank our speakers as well.